chapter 18, verse number 2, it says, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom will I trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation and my high tower." Let's all stand and sing, "Jesus is all the world to me."
All right, let's sing it together. "Jesus is all the world to me." Let's sing. "Jesus is all the world to me. Sunday evening, and I'm thankful you came back this evening. And boy, I don't blame you. It was a good message this morning. We had a sweet spirit in church this morning, and I'm looking forward to what God has in store for us tonight. Why don't we pray together and ask the Lord to speak to us as we get started? I'd like to ask Brother James Smith if you would lead us in prayer. Seated, and again, welcome back tonight. Glad to see everyone here. And I was thankful this afternoon. We had our Next Step Fellowship, and many of you have gone through one of those in your time here as well. And we had a really great spirit at the Next Step Fellowship. And I was so thankful. I actually didn't even leave here, I think, until about 3:30 in the afternoon, because person after person stayed after, and they wanted to talk, they wanted to visit. And some people wanted to get baptized, some people wanted to join the church, and there was one lady who is still seeking the Lord for salvation, but just not quite ready yet, just not quite there yet. So you can pray for her. But I tell you what, if that's what I'm sticking around for, that's just fine, all right? And it was neat to see all of that taking place this afternoon, and I'm sure thankful for what the Lord has been doing in our church. And, you know, one thing I wanted to take a minute to commend our church family on. The Sunday before we went on our vacation last week, we preached from Philippians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. Remember, it was "Beware of Dogs." That was a fun one. And I had mentioned during that message something about something that's taking place in our community, this drag show. How many of you have heard about that? That really, really bothered me, and I know in mentioning it, there were several of you were very bothered by it as well, so much so that many of you had written to our city council and to the library staff as well, and got the venue changed from being at our public library. Unfortunately, there was another institution that took it up after the fact, I think that the fact that they claim to be a church is an even worse thing that took place there. But regardless, I wanted to commend you as a church for being so involved in our community and being willing to take a stand and to express the truth And I think that was a small victory the Lord gave us there. And we've got to keep taking those kinds of stands in our community. And so that's something I wanted to visit with you all about for just a minute, because I do think that's an important thing for us to continue to do as the days grow darker. Obviously, the hope is the gospel and preaching the truth of God's word, but we're still called to be salt and light too in our community. And the salt is a preserving force, and we want to be preservers of the truth. And light, you shine light into the darkness, it chases the darkness away, is what it does. Who would have thought that we'd be even having a conversation like this, where we were told it was supposed to be acceptable to allow these kinds of things. But we don't have to go along with our culture. We can keep standing for truth. And that's certainly what we need to do. And so I commend you as a church for being involved in those things. The last thing I wanted to visit with you about real briefly is I just want to really strongly encourage you to be in prayer throughout this week. In fact, to make it a point to pray specifically that God would begin to work in your heart and prepare you, your family, and our church for our summer awakening, our summer revival that starts next Sunday. We're going to have a guest preacher, Brother Bill Prater and his wife Katie. They're actually going to be with us on Saturday, so Miss Katie Prater will be speaking to our ladies at the brunch that's taking place on Saturday morning, and Brother Bill Prater will be speaking to the men at the men's shootout we're going to have next Saturday. And by the way, if you haven't signed up for those things yet, make sure you do that. We want to make sure we're as prepared as we can be. At the same time, invite friends, invite anybody you can get to come, because that's what this is all about. But they'll be starting to speak to our men and ladies there. But then come Sunday, we'll have Sunday morning, Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night for our revival services. And, you know, God has always used these special times of emphasis of seeking the Lord in our church. And I know that he's going to do it again. But I want to encourage you to make sure that your heart's prepared to receive what the Lord would like to do in our hearts during this revival. And so let's be praying together this week. And I know many of the small groups are planning to have a special emphasis of prayer this week. Our small group is planning to have a special emphasis of prayer, getting ready for the revival services. And it'd be a great thing to make a commonplace thing in your home. Maybe every morning or every evening, just taking some time together to pray that God would prepare your heart for what he'd like to do in your heart during the revival. And that would be a wonderful thing. And so I just want to encourage you with that, give you some spiritual direction, just for our church here, that we would be seeking the Lord and getting our hearts ready for what God would like to do in the revival meeting. I can put it this way, too. We really should be doing that before we come to church every Sunday, if you think about it. Opening up our hearts and asking the Lord, what is it that you would like to speak to me about? And I am thankful for Brother Jim Vangelderan, and that it worked out that they could be with us this week, this weekend. And already his ministry was a blessing this morning, and so I'm thankful for that. Looking forward to what God has in store for us tonight. I'll just tell you, my wife is sick, and she's just gotten worse throughout the day. And priority number one is take care of my family. And so after I'm done here, I'm going to slip out. We're going to watch the message online. I'm going to go take care of Mama for a little bit. And so you'll have to excuse me for that while I go do that. But that's where I need to be. And we'll still be listening online and getting the message that God has for us here this evening. This week, we had a ministry intern with us. Many of you, I hope, have been able to meet Wyatt Golson. And I'm going to have him come up and give a little bit of a testimony of his journey and why he's doing this internship this summer. He's been a big blessing to us throughout the week. We've had him doing anything from cleaning to tearing down walls to cleaning out buses or our vans, teaching, just doing various things. And I hope he's learned a lot, got a lot of good experiences. And in fact, I'm sure he has. But Wyatt, why don't you come and tell us a little bit about what God's called you to do and what the Lord is doing in your heart as an intern this summer.
So, hello, my name is Wyatt Golson. I'm from Moab, Utah. And I was born and raised in a Christian home, grew up in church. I came to know the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior at 5 years old. And that's what's so amazing about the gospel, is it's so simple that a child can believe. Yeah. And soon after that, I believe the Lord has called me to preach. And my sophomore year of high school, I fully surrendered to preaching the gospel at a youth conference at West Coast Baptist College. And my senior year of high school, in 2020, I filled out an application to go to West Coast Baptist College and to study to be a pastor. But in 2020, COVID happened, so it kind of put a stop to my plans. And so that year, I put off West Coast to the next year because I didn't know how I was going to afford it because I got laid off my job. But the Lord made me miserable that summer. He made me miserable, and I knew I needed to take a step of faith and trust in Him, and that He will provide the way for me to go to West Coast so I can learn and train under Him for His ministry. And so I took that step, and I've been there for 2.5 years at West Coast Baptist College, and the Lord has provided every single penny for me to go there, which has been a great blessing. So there's no doubt in my mind that the Lord has called me to preach. And so, and because I believe the Lord has called me to preach, I believe He's put a desire in my heart, a burden, to preach in the Intermountain West. And so through my church, through Moab Baptist Church, my pastor has this ministry called Baptist Church Planting West. And through that ministry, I get to travel to 7 different churches this summer, learning about the different areas of ministry in small communities. And it's been a blessing to see how the Lord uses these ministries. This is the second church I've been to so far, and it's been wonderful. And I thank you, Lighthouse Baptist Church, for giving me the opportunity. And I thank you, Pastor. It's been wonderful. And so as we get ready to sing the next song, I just want to share 2 verses with you. Psalms 23, verse 3 says, "He restoreth my soul, He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake." And 2 Corinthians 12, 9 says, "And He said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me." So let's all stand and sing, "All that thrills my soul."
Amen. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. And some great truth. Let's sing this song together.
Who can cheer the heart like Jesus? Find His presence all divine, true and tender, pure and precious. Oh, how blessed to call Him mine.
Think about it now.
All that thrills my soul is Jesus.
This last verse, when we get up to heaven, our song is still going to be the same. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. Let's sing this last verse.
By the crystal flowing river, with the ransom I will sing. He is more than life to be.
And we're so privileged to have Brother Vangelderan with us again this evening. And we've gotten to know him already. This morning I was talking to a little girl at the Next Step Fellowship. I think her name was Grace. And she was talking about the service. She'd been in the service this morning. And I asked her, did you like the preacher today? And she said, yeah, he was really good. And then she said, he was funny too. I like that. I like a preacher that can get up and really connect with all of us and relate to all of us. And that's such a great biblical message too. I'm excited to hear what Brother Vangelderan has for us tonight. But first, we're going to get to hear again from his daughter and from Brother John and Miss Debbie. And they're going to do a little playing for us here tonight. And it was a blessing this morning, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And I'm excited about this one right here. And so they're going to bless us with a special in song. Then Brother Vangelderan will come preach for us.
But anyway, thank you, Annalise. That's my daughter, Annalise, and she's the last of three. My wife and I had 11 years of marriage, 5 miscarriages, and then God gave us our firstborn in 1995, second born in 97, and 99, Annalise was born. So we thank the Lord for the three young ladies God has given us, and certainly has been a joy to raise them. And one's married, the oldest is married, and Annalise has got one more year in college. She's got her big recital next year, and obviously the violin. So she won't be fiddling in the recital, okay? Her teacher's not going to let her do that. But anyway, so that's Annalise, and a middle daughter, Jana, who has been out of school for a few years and teaches a bunch of music lessons as well. And here's my wife, Rhonda. I'll ask her to stand since she didn't get a chance to get on the platform. We have been married 38 years. Just a few weeks ago, we hit 38. And certainly grateful for the fact that about 3 weeks after we're married, we started on the road, and pretty much have been on the road ever since. So I have to give her credit. I've taken her all over the country, and we live in a tin box, so to speak. I guess they call them travel trailers. And the nice thing about a travel trailer is you got a different front lawn every week. And of course, you don't have to mow it. Of course, around here, I don't think they mow anything. Okay, but anyway, that'd be kind of nice. It certainly was a delight to be with you this morning, and I am certainly looking forward to tonight. And I want to preach a message that might be a little unusual for just a visiting preacher coming through, but I believe it's the one the Lord would have for us. My wife and I, as I've mentioned, have largely been in youth evangelistic ministry for 38 years. For the first 10 years, we conducted a program called The War. We come in with an evangelistic team, small evangelistic team, just 2 young men. They would go into the community, invite kids to The War, which was a Saturday, Sunday, and Monday night outreach. And each night we'd have 2 big major camp type competitions, and then we'd have gospel message, all kinds of other stuff as well. And did that for about 10 years. As I mentioned this morning, God began to burden us for Christian schools. And since the mid-90s, we've been doing that ever since. And now we go into Christian schools, And we come in pretty much on a Sunday there, or Saturday, all the way through the week through Friday night, largely ministering. We have three rally nights that are evangelistic, where we invite kids from the community to come in, and then we minister during the school day to young people. You say, why are you telling us that? Because one of the big issues, there's two issues I found in 38 years. Now, you might be a little bit smarter than I am, but over 38 years, it gets through your thick skull that there's a couple problems. There you see trends, if that makes any sense. And after a while, you begin to realize, well, these are issues we need to hit on a regular basis. Number one, bitterness. No doubt about it. Number one problem, and I talk often about bitterness, got a lot of messages that deal with it, got a lot of messages that deal with father issues, etc., mother issues. In fact, a well-known guy who deals with sexual addictions and from a Christian perspective, Dr. Ted Roberts, has some of you familiar with him from the Cocker series. He said 98% of all the men that he deals with in sexual addictions have deep father wounds in their souls. Did you catch that? 98%. Huge problems today with bitterness. But the second one, is like I've already kind of alluded to it, is the issues of moral impurity. That's the second major issue we deal with teenagers, sexual sin. Largely today, it's in the issue of viewing. Not that it doesn't manifest itself in other ways, it does. But probably the number one way among that is viewing inappropriate materials. And I think you all understand what I'm talking about. So I'm gonna, in light of that, preach a message I normally preach to young people, but I think we all can benefit from it, Bible truth. And I wanna preach a simple message and then answer it, the question. Actually, the title is the question, and then we're gonna answer it, and the question is this. What is moral purity? What is moral purity? It certainly is a question that needs to be answered from a biblical perspective, and then we'll walk through this tonight. I hope it'll be a help even for adults to guide young people. Because I don't know about you, sometimes we get the idea that God's just waiting for us to step out of bounds so he can clobber us. That's really not true. God wants us to stay in bounds for a reason. When that little girl was born in 1995, our firstborn, my wife had five, like I said, miscarriages, first trimester miscarriages. So when Stephanie was born in 1995, I don't know how to explain it, my wife and I were just exploding with love for that little girl. And as a result, I think with all three of our girls, and most of you, the parent, would get the same feeling, there were certain things we didn't want her to do, like playing in the street. You with me on this? Now, hardly anybody ever drove down our street. It was a side street, but that didn't matter. We did everything we could to protect her and keep her away from danger. Now, I will tell you something. God is a greater parent than any human parent is, and he's trying to keep us away from danger, too. And I tell young people, listen, no good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. God's not trying to take blessing from you. He's trying to give blessing to you. And that's why he gives boundaries. And those boundaries are to protect you from things that are destructive. And we see a lot of destruction today, a lot of issues. And I would submit to you that some of the problems adults in this room have are unresolved issues out of your teenage years that you've never approached from a biblical perspective. And I will find on moral purity, I will tell you, if I preach on at camp, and moral purity I do every week, many times I'll have a bus driver or a camp kitchen helper, some adult come to me and say these words, Brother Vangelderan, I wish I'd heard that when I was a teenager. There's some things I did that I wish I hadn't done, and I got some regrets as a result of that. And I will tell you, it motivates me to preach it on a regular basis and try to help people understand a biblical perspective of morality, which we're fast losing. You're not going to find it in the public school. You're not going to find it in Time Magazine, Newsweek, or even Fox News. But you are going to find it in the Word of God. And so I want you to begin by going to 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4. And I want us to begin the message on what is moral purity. What is moral purity? We could also say conversely, what is moral impurity? We're going to begin in 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4. I want you to begin with verse number 3. The Bible's going to help us start here to lay out the truth here, and hopefully it'll be a help. The Bible says, for this is the will of God. Wow, that's amazing. Most of us want to know, what's the will of God? Okay, here it is. This is the will of God, even your sanctification, that ye should abstain from fornication. Now, there's a very interesting grammatical phenomena that's occurring right here in this passage of Scripture. Right after the phrase, this is the will of God, even your sanctification, there are five infinitives in the Greek language. And what God is saying is, there are five things I want you to know are the will of God. These are five things you need to take seriously. First one, we just read it, to abstain from fornication. But I want you to go down to infinitive 4 and infinitive 5 in verse number 6. It says that no man go beyond and defraud his brother in any manner, because the Lord is the avenger of all such, as we have forewarned you and testified. So what God is saying is this is the will of God, to not go beyond and to not defraud. Now, these two are two negative ones. God says, I don't want you to do this. Now, what does that mean, to not go beyond and to not defraud? Well, not go beyond is pretty simple. It means don't go beyond the boundary. It does, don't go out of bounds. Most of us have seen crime scenes or seen things like that where police have up tape, and you know what they're saying? Don't go over the boundary. There's consequences if you do. I understand it down in Tampa Bay, there's CENTCOM, Central Command, the United States Armed Forces, and I'm understanding that CENTCOM is on the bay. And I'm understanding that part of that, there are certain parameters set up on the bay, and basically if you go beyond those parameters, guess what they do? They kill you. They shoot to kill. Now, I don't know about you, that's not a boundary I'd be interested in transgressing. What do you think? You know what I'm talking about? I don't think I'd want to transgress that boundary. Now, that's what God's telling us here. Don't go out of bounds. On a less serious nature, that would be the idea of sports. You know, almost every sport I've ever noticed has boundaries. Yeah, boundaries. Now, I don't know why. I, of course, moved to Chicago at 6 years old, so I fell in love with the Chicago Cubs. And I will tell you something, friends, there is a great benefit to being a Cubs fan. You learn how to cope with disillusionment early in life. Okay, because the Cubs don't just lose. They make you think they're going to win before they do. Okay, now 16 was just a blip on the road. It's going to be another 108 years before they do it again. But anyway, I kind of like baseball. And probably one of the greatest rivalries in baseball is the Boston Red Sox and the New York Yankees. And several years ago, back when I was younger, there was a guy by the name of Carlton Fisk at the plate. They called him Pudge. That means he was kind of fat. Okay, but anyway, and Pudge was at the plate, and they're playing the New York Yankees, and they were in Fenway Park, Boston. And, you know, if you know anything about it, man, that is just quite a series. And I think whoever won it was going to go to the World Series. And Pudge was at the plate, got a pitch, and then he got all of it. You know what I'm talking about? Home run distance. No doubt about it, it's home run distance. The question was it going to go fair, or was it going to go foul? And there's video footage, you can watch it, of Carlton Fisk facing the baseball, going toward first base, doing this. Like that's going to do any good. But anyway, he's doing this. And all of a sudden, you can watch Carlton Fisk jump into the air. Why? Because it was a fair ball. And the Boston Red Sox just won that game. Okay, so we understand boundaries are significant. So what God is saying is, don't go out of bounds. Stay in bounds. And then when he says something else, don't defraud. Which really infers, if you go out of bounds, you're defrauding. Now, don't miss this. You say, preacher, what is defraud? Sometimes you've heard on the radio, probably, haven't you? Maybe you heard some kind of newscast talked about some big company got defrauded. And what happened? They got scammed. They got conned. They got ripped off. Okay, so the word literally means, defraud means, don't miss this, to have more. To have more. It means taking more than is rightfully yours to take. Let's just imagine you're down here at Walmart shopping, okay? Have you ever noticed at Walmart that the prices are more expensive than they were last week? Okay, but anyway, and so you're down there at Walmart, and you're shopping down there, and let's just imagine this happened a few years ago. Because I'm sure some of you, you've got Walmart prices memorized. You with me on that? I'm talking the old prices before things started going haywire, because they were the same for years. Listen, I could go to a different state, whatever, and I could tell you exactly what it was going to be. Okay, certain things that I buy. Okay, so anyway, you're down there at Walmart. Let's just imagine you have $100 in your pocket. You forgot your wallet. All you got is $100 sitting in your pocket. So you're calculating this thing up because all you got is $100. So you come to the checkout lane and you know you've got to figure it out. $99.98 with tax. That's what it's going to be. $99.98. You're going to have 2 pennies left over. And here you are going through the line. And while you're going through the line, you look up and you notice there's a new bubblegum flavor. You know what I'm talking about? Have you ever noticed some of these crazy flavors they come up with? Guacamole, sour cream. I don't know what anyway. You know what I'm talking about? Salsa. But anyway, and so you see this new flavor, you think, I got to have it. Now, I hope you wouldn't do this. You thought, I got to have that, but I only got 2 pennies. I'm not going to be able to do this. So I hope you wouldn't do this, but you grab the bubblegum, kind of secretly put it in your pocket. You go out, you pay $99.98, get 2 pennies left over, walk out. Guess what you just did? Defrauded Walmart. You say, how can I defraud a man? I paid $100, but you took more than was rightfully yours to take. You see what defraud means? Okay, here's what God's saying. Is when somebody in the moral arena, that's clearly what 1 Thessalonians is talking about, chapter number 4, in the moral arena, when you step over the line, you're taking more than is rightfully yours to take. And I will tell young people, I challenge them, listen, man, if you've stolen, you need to get right with God. Because the Bible says if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So I encourage young people, fall on their face before God and say, God, I'm a thief. I'm a thief. I've taken that which was not rightfully mine to take. You say, why is that such a big deal? Because God says, if you'll go back there to verse number 6, it says, because that the Lord is the avenger of all such, as we have also forewarned you and testified. You say, preacher, what in the world does that mean? Can I be honest with you tonight? I don't know, but if I were you, I wouldn't want to find out. What do you think? God's pretty strong language, isn't it? You know what God's saying? It's a big deal to steal. It's a big deal. We're going to talk about that in a moment. We're not talking about theft of things. We're talking theft in the arena of morality. So I want you to understand that and see that, because God's evidently awful serious about it. That's why I encourage young people, get right with God. Just get right with God, because He's faithful and just to forgive and to cleanse. But you got to confess, which means agree with God. I'm a thief, God, I'm a thief. And God begins to cleanse. That's a wonderful thing. That's one of the reasons I'm preaching the message, because you cannot properly confess sin until you see what God thinks about it. Then you can properly confess sin. Okay, so I think we're seeing some things here about boundaries and staying in bounds. So in bounds is purity, and clearly out of bounds is impurity. I think we're seeing that clearly in this passage of Scripture. Now go to James chapter number 4, because you're probably saying, okay, preacher, now how in the world can I know what's in bounds, and how can I know what's out of bounds? Sometimes teenagers will say, well, preacher, what's the line? What's the line? Well, I want to tell you something, friends. How would you like to play a football game or a soccer game where the lines were infrared lines that only the refs could see with special glasses? They could see the lines, but you as a player couldn't see the lines. Would you like to play in a game like that? I don't think so. And you know, friends, God doesn't do that to us. God's not saying, hey, play the game of life. You don't know where the lines are, but I do. You step over that line, you're going to get hit. No, God doesn't do that. God's going to tell us tonight. He tells young people, He tells all of us exactly where the moral purity lines are. And I want to just simply challenge you, what is moral purity? And then we're going to make three applications and be done. Now, James chapter number 4 is going to help us as we try to find that. We've determined that that God says stay in the lines. Don't go beyond the boundaries. Don't go out of bounds into impurity. And He says, because if you do, you're going to be defrauding, taking more than is rightfully yours to take. That brings us then to what's the line? What is the line? Now, we're going to see a very clear line here. And I believe it'll be a help to you. Now, James chapter 4, look what verse number 4 says. It says, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Now, did you notice those first few words of that verse are pretty blunt? What do you think? Ye adulterers and adulteresses, how would you like to be a recipient of that letter? Wow. Pretty strong language, isn't it? Now, what is James? He's, of course, the pastor. He's their pastor. They've been scattered abroad because of persecution. What is he really saying here? Okay, I believe he's talking about spiritual adultery. Spiritual adultery. But he is using a picture. Now, the picture is simply this, that you and I right now, did you know that you're a part of the bride of Christ? If you're saved on your way to heaven, you're a part of the bride. And there's coming a day when the trumpet's going to sound and the bride's going up and there's going to be a marriage supper of the Lamb. And our bridegroom, our fiancé, Jesus Christ, is going to be united with the bride. Okay, we understand that. I think most of us do. I heard years ago in North Dakota of a young man and a young lady who decided to illustrate Christ in the church. What do you think about that? And so the guy comes to the girl, his girlfriend, says, will you marry me? And the girl says yes. Have you ever been shocked when the girl says yes? But okay, we'll just leave that alone. Okay, but anyway, the guy says, will you marry me? And the girl says yes. And here's what the guy said. He said, you're not going to know what the wedding day is. He said, we're going to illustrate Christ in the church, and the church doesn't know when the wedding day is. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to get ready for the wedding and get ready for the honeymoon, and you won't know what day it is until the actual day. Now, fortunately, he called her in the morning, and the wedding was in the evening. But that's all the front. Now, ladies, isn't this wonderful? Aren't you just pumped up about this? Isn't this romantic? Unbelievable. Some of you unmarried girls want to take some notes on this. And you say, well, preacher, how'd they pull it off? Well, the whole church knew the day. She never found out, but the whole church knew what the day was. I said, what day of the week did you pick? He said, I picked Monday. I said, Monday for a wedding? Why did you pick Monday? He said, I was sure that was the one day she'd figure I'd never do. I'm thinking, great way to start a wedding. Yeah, marriage, isn't it? But anyway, and so that's exactly what happened. She had no idea, had her bags packed for the honeymoon, had no idea when the wedding was. And one day, her husband-to-be called her up one morning and said, honey, today's the day. Now, you older folks are going to know what I mean by this, but man, I'd love to have seen candid camera on that call. You know what I'm talking about? I'm telling you, there must have been a total freak out. I mean, just a total freak out. And I'm getting married today. How'd you like that? I'm getting married today. And of course, they started the wedding. I'm telling you, this is unbelievable. They started the wedding without the bride. You ever seen a wedding start without the bride? But that's exactly what happened. She was back home. And the whole church gathered. They took all the pews out and they brought in tables. Have you ever heard of marriage supper of the Lamb? Now, folks, these were hermeneutical literalists. They were dispensationalists. If you have no idea what they're talking about, tell you, ask your pastor. Okay, but anyway, they were into this stuff. And so they started that ceremony with a banquet, so to speak. And the very first thing was the father said to his son, "You may get the bride. You may go get your bride." That's called the rapture. Okay, you know what I'm talking about. These folks are just illustrating it. And so this guy gets in his car, drives over to his fiance's bride-to-be house. And I looked at him and I said, "Okay, bud, you got to level with me on this deal." I said, "Did you break the speed limit? Go and get your bride." He looked at me and smiled, didn't answer me. Okay, but anyway, and so he goes. Now I'll tell you one breakdown in the whole thing, and it really is a huge breakdown. He didn't bring a trumpet with him. As far as I'm concerned, he should have blown the trumpet outside. What do you think? But anyway, he got her in the car, brought her back, and they had the wedding. Okay, now that's the picture here. You say, "Preacher, what do you mean?" Well, friends, I want to ask you a question. When's the wedding to Jesus? Well, we don't know. One day there's going to be a trumpet, and we're going to, father's going to say to the son, "You can get your bride." And Jesus is going to come get his bride. There's going to be a trumpet, and we're going to be ascended up, and there's going to be the marriage supper of the Lamb. Now, preacher, what does that have to do with verse number 4? It has a lot of things to do with it. You know what God's saying here? He's saying, "Listen, you adulterers and adulteresses, here you are engaged to Jesus, flirting with the world." He said, "You're in spiritual adultery." See the picture? Okay, so that's the idea of what's going on here. Now, obviously, you and I have heard of situations where we can probably understand this in a negative sense. You may be known of a soldier who gets engaged to his girlfriend, says, "Will you marry me?" She says, "Yes." He said, "Well, I'm going to be deployed." He said, "You get ready for the wedding. As soon as I come back from deployment, we'll set a date as quickly as we can and get married." Now, that happens all the time. Okay, the soldier gets deployed. Let's just imagine it lasts longer than both of them wanted it to. And then you begin to notice this girl's flirting with other guys. You begin to notice she's going on dates, and then you hear worse is going on. Now, you know what the world calls that? Don't miss it. She's two-timing. Did you notice the word, the number there? 2. Did you know the Bible has the same word? In James chapter 1, you know what he calls it? Double-minded. Double-minded. Now, isn't that fascinating? Now, I want us to stop for a moment, and I'm going to give you an analogy, and then we're going to come back to the text, and I think it will help. How many of you, when you were in high school, took chemistry? I'm just curious, how many took chemistry? How many chemistry took you, like to the cleaners? Okay, but anyway, don't raise your hand. Okay, but anyway, all you chemists out here, we're going to use the word chemist very lightly tonight, but all you chemists out here, if you have pure gold, how many elements do you have? How many? How many elements do you have if you have pure? This is not trying to be a trick question. Yeah, how many elements? This young lady back here has got the right answer. She's holding up this little light of mine. Exactly, one. Right there, one. Okay, now don't miss this. If you adulterate the gold, did you notice the word pure? Did you notice the word adulterate? I'm not sure if morality borrowed it from chemistry or chemistry from morality, but if you adulterate the gold, how many elements do you have? And the answer is 2 or more. 2 or more. Wow. So what I believe the Lord is saying here, hey, listen, folks, you're engaged to Jesus. What are you doing flirting with the world? You're double-minded. Okay, now in verse number 8, he has a solution. Don't miss the solution, because in the solution, we're going to find the answer to what is moral purity. Okay, verse number 8, draw nigh to God, he'll draw nigh to you. Here it is. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and here's the key phrase, purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Okay, here it is. I'm going to ask you a question. Engage to Jesus, flirting with the world. God says, you're double-minded. You're two-timing it. You need to purify your heart, she double-minded. If you purified your heart, you'd no longer be double-minded. You'd be? Let's try it again. Engaged to Jesus, flirting with the world. God says, you're two-timing it. You're double-minded. You need to purify your heart, she double-minded. If you purified your heart, you'd no longer be double-minded. You'd be? Yeah, you got it. You know what is moral purity? It's all aspects of intimacy that God created for a husband and wife in the bonds of marriage with one. That's moral purity. Now, I want to ask you a question. Verse number 4, James chapter 4. Is the church married to Jesus yet? And the answer is No. And notice what God calls them. Adulterers. I tell young people everywhere, you can adulterate the purity of a future marriage by introducing someone who is not your spouse into intimacy that God only created for a husband and wife. Now, obviously, our world is messed up, isn't it? I've had young people come to the microphone on our testimony service and said, man, I made a decision. I'm going to keep myself pure until marriage. Now, I know what they mean, and I know they mean it sincerely, but actually, definition-wise, they're not correct. Because, my friend, if you keep yourself pure to marriage, marry and are faithful to your wife or husband, then you're still pure. See, purity is all about one. That's what it's about. Keeping all aspects of intimacy that God created for marriage, keeping into the bonds of marriage for your spouse. Okay, so it's single-mindedness. That's moral purity. Now I want to make three applications tonight, and we'll be done. Okay, number one application, physical purity. So physical purity is keeping your body for how many? It's keeping your body for how many? The answer is one. Just one. All aspects of touch that kindle a fire, keeping it for one. Now, I don't know about you. I think the Bible's fascinating. But the Bible uses an analogy of passion that is very helpful. And the analogy is fire. Fire. Can a man take fire into his bosom, his clothes not be burned? Can one go upon hot coals and his feet not be burned? So he that goeth into his neighbor's wife, whosoever no misses, toucheth her, shall not be innocent. Now those are God's words. What in the world is he talking about? Well, let's talk about fire for a moment. We'll come back to this. This is fascinating to me. I just love the Bible. It is so up to date. It's unbelievable. Okay, fire. You know, I assume you folks in Cortez like fire, at least in the wintertime. You know what I'm talking about? I'm telling you, we folks in Wisconsin love fire. I mean, we love it. 20 below, it gets 20 below, actual. Not wind chill, actual. We love fire. We love fire in the furnace. Yes, yes. We love fire in the hot water heater. Well, I'm not sure I should say hot water here. One time I was preaching, a teenager came up to me a little smug afterwards, and he said, now, Brother Vangelderan, you said hot water heater. It's not a hot water heater. It's a water heater. You see, it doesn't heat hot water. It just heats water. Now, aren't you thankful for teenagers who have this great wisdom, who bestow this wisdom upon you? You know, I'm talking to us poor, benighted adults. You know what? I'm just going to call it a hot water heater. What do you think? Okay, and I'll tell you where I love fire. Fireplace. You know what I'm talking about? Arm around your wife with a cup of Dunkin' Donuts coffee. Yeah, you can get a Durango now. I saw it over there. Okay, yeah, there it is. I'm telling you, snow lightly falling outside the window. Unbelievable. Life didn't get a whole lot better than that. But here's the point. Yeah, we like fire. But all of us know that if fire gets out of its proper place, it's destructive. Several years ago, my oldest daughter and I were getting off an airplane. We had just been to a wedding or coming back. I can't remember. And as we got off the airplane, the lady about three or four rows up had opened up the overhead bin and was pulling luggage out of the overhead bin. And in doing so, she wasn't trying to look at us, but she turned around and we completely saw her, and her face was completely scarred. I recognized the scarring as coming from fire. Probably she was wearing a wig. I'm assuming it was in... Every square inch of skin was burned, and grotesquely burned. I say this carefully and as compassionately as I know how, because there may be somebody listening who has a loved one who's experienced burns, and I'm not trying to in any way be inappropriate. I'm just trying to help you understand something, that she obviously had been tragically burned, and I will tell you, every bit of her feminine beauty was gone. You know, I'm going to tell you why. Fire. Fire. I promise every young person in this room, you mess around with some girl you're not married to, but you mark this, you're going to get burned. And young lady, you mess around with that guy, but you mark my words, you're going to get burned. Every single time. God uses the picture of fire. Now, the amazing thing about that picture is it relates to some words that sometimes I have heard literally even preachers laugh off or explain away. How about this verse found in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse number 1? It is good for a man, anybody know, not to touch a woman. You say, Richard, what do you think that verse means? Well, if you look at the word touch, it's a very interesting word. It's from the Greek word opto. It's in the middle voice, optomai. And if you look at the definitions, obviously one of the definitions, it's touch. But one of the other definitions, I think, really helps us, to kindle. to kindle. It's clearly a touch that kindles a fire. And what God is saying, it's good for men and women who are not married not to touch in any way that kindles a fire. Isn't the Bible practical? I'm thinking, man, that's practical. Unbelievable. It's exactly the same word. Of course, the Old Testament's Hebrew, New Testament Greek, but in the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Old Testament, the word touch that we just used in Proverbs chapter 6, can a man take fire in his bosom, his clothes not be burned? Can one go upon hot coals, his feet not be burned? So he that goeth into his neighbor's wife, whosoever toucheth her, same word. It's a touch that kindles a fire. Now, I'm saying this to every man, every woman. Listen, before you got married, you messed around, kindled fire with someone who wasn't your spouse. I'm telling you, you sinned against Almighty God. But I got really good news for you. If you'll get honest with God and say, God, I'm a thief, he'll forgive you. Yeah. But you're not going to know the restoring power of the blood of Jesus Christ as long as you say, oh, it's not that big a deal. Everybody's doing it. That's not how you get right with God. You know how you get right with God? God, you're right, I'm wrong. Physical purity is keeping all aspects of touch that kindle passion and kindle a fire for one in the bonds of marriage. I don't know about you. That seems pretty clear, doesn't it? It's like, whoa, isn't that like, wow? That's so practical. Now, you might be out here and say, oh, preacher, man, everybody's messing around. Everybody's doing junk. Well, number one, not everybody is. Don't believe that lie. And every one of them that are messing around, one day we'll regret it. Because fire always scars. So number one, physical purity. Number two, by the way, that's not the hardest point. Number two is harder. Mental purity. So physical purity is keeping your body for one. Mental purity is keeping your mind for how many? For how many? For one. So intimate thoughts should only be in the way, in the mind of a married person about their spouse. And any intimate thoughts that are about somebody you're not married to, you're a thief. I should have mentioned this earlier, but if you're messing around with somebody and you're kindling passion, I'm telling you, outside the bonds of marriage, you're a thief too. You're stealing from yourself, you're stealing from the person you're with, you're stealing from your future mate, and you're stealing from their future mate. You're a thief. That's what God says. But when it comes to the mental arena, there's thievery there as well. Every time a man looks at pornography, he's a thief. I don't care if he's single. He's stealing from his future mate. Every time a man indulges in lustful, sensual fantasizing, he's a thief. Same with a woman. Every time a woman reads a romantic novel and begins to think romantic thoughts about a man not her husband, she's a thief. You say, preacher, this is pretty strong. May I say, it's just the Bible. I will tell you, I've got more trouble for quoting God. But anyway, I'm just telling you what he's saying, okay? You say, preacher, I got an issue with this. Well, fine, go out afterwards, have an issue. God will be glad to talk to you about it. Don't worry about me. I'm just telling you what he said, okay? I'm just the messenger, okay? Don't get us mixed up on the deal, okay? But it's like old Oliver Green, the old radio preacher, said. He said, man, he said, if the phone's ringing, answer it. I'm just dialing the number. Okay, so there it is. So mental purity, keeping your mind for one. Now, I'm telling you, there has never been a day, I don't know, on planet Earth, where there has not been more, there's more opportunity to have the purity of our mind sullied by filth. It's just everywhere. Which means it mandates for every believer in this room, men and women, because this issue is a women issue. 30% of all women sitting in evangelical churches on Sunday morning are struggling with sexual addictions. My wife has several Bible college girls, young ladies that she's dealing with that are into sexual addictions. This is not a male problem just alone. Now, the male is a more percentage. 70% of all men sitting in evangelical churches are struggling with sexual addiction. Some of you that have seen Conquer series know what I'm talking about. Most of that is viewing. Most of that is looking at inappropriate things on the internet. So mental purity is keeping your mind for one. Which means you've got to be extremely careful. And what it mandates, because there's so much success, the issue today is accessibility. Now, has it been there? It's been there for decades. Ever since the printing press, it wasn't long after that. Obviously, I'm sure somewhere along the line, there began, especially some of the early part of this century and into that, and obviously this became a part of culture. And of course, during the free love of the 60s, by the way, I call the free love of the 60s the expensive lust of the 60s. Number one, it wasn't free, and number two, it wasn't love. But anyway, that set our country down this road. But here's the thing I want you to understand about it. Accessibility has really caused a problem. You know, when I went to Bible college, I don't remember one preacher boy that struggled with looking at pornography. I'm sure a few did, but I didn't know of any of them. Now, the preacher boy class I was in, there was 1,000 preacher boys. 1,000 preacher boys studying for the ministry. This is back in the late 70s, early 80s. I don't remember one. I'm sure a few were, but pornography was not a big issue. I'm telling you now, 90%, I guarantee you this, 90% of young men in independent Baptist Bible colleges that are preparing for the ministry are struggling with this issue of pornography. Or at least have, or are presently. It's a huge issue today. And the answer is, you say, well, preacher, why? Accessibility. Back when in the 90s, I used to preach, of course, I preach at camps, and I used to preach on not having a TV in your bedroom. And I preach on that. And here's how I preach on it. I'd be preaching on being careful, et cetera, and whatever. And I'd say this to young people. If you have a TV in your bedroom and you have never watched anything to offend Almighty God, let me know. I made that challenge to at least, I would say, 10,000 teenagers. Do you know how many teenagers came to me and said, I got a TV in my bedroom and I've never watched anything to offend Almighty God? Do you know how many? One. Had a kid come to me, he said, now, Brother Ben Gilbert, he said, oh, by the way, he said, I got a TV in my bedroom, never watched anything to offend Almighty God. I said, wow, that's great. How did you pull that one off? He said, I never turned it on. Okay. Say, preacher, why are you preaching on that? Here's the point. Satan's greatest weapon to keep you in sexual addictions and viewing things you shouldn't is secrecy. I'm telling you a secret. There's many young men that I'm working with that this has been an issue in their life. And by the way, I'm telling you tonight, if I had Star Trek technology, and I don't, and I could beam you in 20 guys at least tonight who could stand at this pulpit and tell you about the fact that they were hooked on looking at filth, but they've had sustained victory, some for months, some for years. God is doing some great things, and I'm pumped about it and excited about what God is doing, delivering these young men from this vice grip of lust. But the point is, you know what gets them? Secrecy. And every guy will tell you, the first step to victory is total honesty. In fact, I'm going to tell you something tonight that might shock you. But tonight, there will be several young men who, via Marco Polo, will check in their accountability group. They have 24-hour accountability, and they will report to the group what they've looked at that they shouldn't have. They will also report on your thought life. How would you like to every 24 hours have to report on your thought life? You say, preacher, why do they do that? Because they're sick of it and they want victory. And these guys are seeing unbelievable victory. You know why? Because they're not playing the game anymore. No more secrecy. I was talking to a young man just a few weeks ago, and he was telling me how much he said, Brother Van Gelderen, he said, I have not gone back to look in the filth, but he said, I am so defeated in my mind. And he said, I've just thought filth, and he was so broken down. But he said, I had a leader in his life told him, he said, you know what your problem is? You need to get honest about your thought life. He said, and I went to my accountability group, because he's on 24-hour accountability, but he wasn't being brutally honest. And he said, I got brutally honest. He said, I can honestly say, since I've been brutally honest, he said, I've had victory I haven't had in a long time. You see, the point, friends, with this secrecy is killing us. It's absolutely killing us. And if you've got a problem with lust and you want victory, I tell you right now, there's a way out. There's a way out. But the way out will not be acting like you're something you're not. The way out will be getting brutally honest. Mental purity is keeping your mind for one. Now, if you're going to keep your mind for one, guess what? You got to be careful what you look at. Did you know God makes a connection between the eye gate and the mind? Did you know that? In fact, it's interesting. Job said, I've made a covenant with mine eyes. Why then should I think upon a maid? Jesus said, whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Solomon said, lust not after beauty, eyes in thine heart. Wow. So what you look at is what you think about. Did you know that? And what you think about if left unchecked is what you one day will do. As he thinketh in his heart, the Bible says, so is he. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. I'm telling you, young people, even older people, you can look at filth, but the problem is you just put it on your hard drive. And I'm telling you, I know of two young men who came clean about the junk they've been looking at and began to walk with God in ways they never thought they could, began to get brutally honest, who have told me God has given them, don't miss this, divine forgetfulness. Divine forgetfulness. He said, many of those sensual images, I can't even remember them anymore. Now, if you know anything about what I'm talking about, that's a miracle. That's a miracle. But I'm telling you, friends, the eye gate is where it comes in, and then the brain, and what you think about if left unchecked is what you one day will do. Jesus said in Mark 7, from within, out of the heart of men proceed evil thoughts, murders, adultery, thefts, false witness, and the list goes on. Greek scholars tell us that the way that is lined out, that every sin in that list finds its origin in evil thoughts. No shock there, is it? You see, so what are you saying, preacher? Well, number one, you got to be careful what you look at. You know what I'm finding today? God's people aren't careful what they look at. And wondering why their mind is filthy. I'm telling you, you got to be careful what you look at. Entertainment issues, social media, just all this technology, video games. It's everywhere. It's every TikTok. It's all over the place. You got to be careful what you look at. Okay, and then if you've already said, preacher, I've already looked at stuff I haven't. Well, I'm telling you, I shouldn't have. I've looked at things I wish I hadn't have. Okay, well, the answer then is you're going to have some detergent to clean out your brain. Now, I don't have time to go into it all, but the greatest detergent to clean out your brain is the Word of God. Every Word of God is clean. Proverbs 30, verse 5. John 15, 5, now you clean through the Word which I've spoken unto you. Now, there's other truth, and there's several truths that God can use to deliver young men who are addicted to looking at filth, but I don't have time to go into it except to just simply say, mark it down, mental purity is keeping your mind for how many? For one. For one. That means everybody in this room has a responsibility. What you look at, how you dress yourself, all of us is a responsibility in the regard of recognizing mental purity is keeping your mind for one, keeping your eye for one. And every man in this room understands it, even some ladies do. The battle here, don't have time to fully develop it except the challenges about that. You say, oh, preacher, this is impossible. You can't do this. But like I preached this morning, in your flesh you can't, but you can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. And I'm telling you, the victory, these guys are no longer white knuckling. You know what white knuckling is? Yeah, white knuckling is what happens to me when somebody takes me on a four-wheeler in Colorado, okay? It's called white knuckling. It's like, man, we're going to die. You know, that kind of thing, white knuckling. Okay, that's not white knuckling. Listen, all these guys in victory have white knuckled, and you know what they'll tell you? You can only white knuckle for so long, and then you're back. You need supernatural deliverance. You need God to show up and deliver you. Don't have time to develop it fully, but there's some great truth. In fact, at this very point, Falls Baptist Church is developing a video, 14-week video series, kind of along the Conqueror series line, except it's dealing with some other complementary truth on the issue of having victory and moral purity issues called Renew. We're very excited about it. We've already started the filming, etc. But so mental purity, keeping your mind for one, and let's go to the last one. Okay, physical purity, keeping your body for one. Mental purity, keeping your mind for one. Hang on. Emotional purity, hang on. Anybody want to guess? Keeping your heart for one. So how many people should you madly fall in love with? How many people, let me put it this way. How many spiritual loves does Jesus want you to have? One. That's what's going on in verse 4. Why are you flirting with the world? You're engaged to Jesus. You're in spiritual adultery. You're double-minded. Literally, double-souled is the idea there. Wow. Okay, so emotional purity is keeping your heart for one. Now, we have all seen the immaturity of this. You've been driving out in the country and go over a railroad, under a railroad underpass, and somebody spray-painted on the overpass, I love Sally forever. Oh, isn't that cute? You know what I'm talking about, isn't that cute? Only problem is a month later you come back, poor Sally's name's been spray painted out. You know what I'm talking about? Now it's Mary Jo. Wow, that forever wasn't very long. What do you think? And we all know the immaturity of that. You see, the truth is emotional purity, young people, is keeping your heart for one. It's not going in and out of relationships. It's not throwing I love you around like it's something cheap. It's keeping your heart for one. I'm going to keep my heart for my future wife. I'm going to keep my heart for my future husband. You say, preacher, have you seen the guys around these days? Some of you dear ladies out here, you know, have you seen some of the guys? I know. Yeah, we got problems out there, but I got really good news for you. You only need one. Amen. Only need one. You say, my parents, there's no God planet Earth that's going to get through. My parents, only need one. Just need one to get through. Just one. And I will tell you, friends, I'll be honest with you. I'm telling you, if you're out there thinking, looking for a future mate, it doesn't look good out there. I got that. But after you pray. And by the way, I encourage every unmarried person in this room, you start praying for your future spouse. Start praying for them right now. And if you're a young lady, pray they won't look at that junk. Pray they'll keep. Listen, I know young men that are in college and haven't looked at filth yet. Haven't looked at it. They're not planning on looking at filth. You don't have to be a casual. There are exceptions. And thank the Lord for them. And but anyway, emotional purity is keeping your heart for just one. And I'm sure you've heard this. Back a few years ago, Facebook was talking about the fact there's a little bit of a problem because people are getting on Facebook finding their first love. Their marriage wasn't going so well, so they find that little junior high girl they fell for there in seventh grade. And you know what they found out? She's having trouble in her marriage. Well, it's a recipe for disaster, right? So you got two broken marriages, they get together, and of course it doesn't. You know the only problem with that? They brought their baggage from their first marriage into their second marriage. And you say, well, preacher, what are you saying? I'm saying this. If you keep your heart, and with God's leadership, marry your first love, guess what happens? When you have trouble in your marriage, and you go back to your first love, you're still married. You didn't get that, did you? Okay, think about it for a moment. Okay, you didn't get that. So you marry your first love. Then you have trouble, you go back to your first love, you're still married. Okay, you're not getting it. Okay, but anyway, work hard at it. I want you to get this. Okay, now some of you dear adults out here, I'm going to just say this as carefully as I know how. I'm not here tonight to rub salt wounds. I don't know your story. I know some of you have things you regret. I get that. But I've learned this, that adults who've taken God's side against their own sin have no trouble when the preacher gets up and tries to keep other young people from making the same mistakes they made. So please understand, I'm not trying to rub salt in your wounds. I'm just telling you, we're in trouble, but God's got a way out. You don't have to be a statistic. And I'm encouraging every young man and every young lady in this room, you know what you ought to do? Keep your heart for just one. Keep your body for one. Keep your mind for one. And I realize that's a battle. You won't do it perfectly, but I'm telling you, you can have more victory than you think you can because his name is Jesus. You can be pure. Keep your mind for one and keep your heart. That's what moral purity is. And I'm going to shock you with this. Do you know who designed that? Don't miss this. God did. God did. Now I'm just going to conclude with this because some of you out here say, you know, preacher, you're just preaching pie in the sky. I'm telling you, this is a different day. My mother grew up in a town that Guinness Book of World Records at the time said had the most bars per capita. Men would drive down from Chicago to get drunk. And my mother was a wonderful woman. She died prematurely. It's the day before her 65th birthday because of battling cancer. But she would age appropriately warn me. And I remember my mother pulling me aside one day and said, Jim, you got to understand something. Alcohol and sexual sin go together. She said, I saw him coming out of the bars. And she appropriately warned me about this kind of stuff. So she lived in a very wicked town. Now, this is way back. She graduated in the early 40s. And she said when she graduated, it was either her and one other or herself alone was the only virgins left in the senior class in their town. This is years ago. Now, here's the amazing thing about it. You say, oh, man, she must have had wonderful parents. She must have had a great church. The truth is, she really didn't have either. She went to church, but it was a much weaker church than you're experiencing here. And her mom died when she was 9 of a brain aneurysm. And her father died at 14 of old age. Her father was 59 when she was born. She's the only virgin left or the only one other in the senior class. You say, preacher, how in the world that happened? I'll just tell you how it happened. God. I'm telling you, friends, God's into this. You know, you ever thought about the fact if you're saved, the Holy Spirit lives in you? Did you catch the Holy Spirit's first name? Sometimes we forget his first name. And I'm telling you, that Holy Spirit can enable you to be holy. You don't have to be a statistic. And I'm telling you this, I don't have time. I could preach on this literally all night long because I'm dealing with this stuff all the time. And if you have a propensity toward moral impurity, the truth is many times, I'm telling you, it's because you have undealt with bitternesses in your heart. A young lady who's loose almost always has a terrible relationship with her father. Those things can be remedied. And there are solutions. I don't have time to go into it all, but I want you to understand there is a way out. And hallelujah, the grace of God is big. So what is moral purity? It's keeping your body, your mind, and your heart for one. Can I ask every head bowed, please, and every eye closed, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. You've done a wonderful job tonight. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'll just ask you to stand to your feet. If you don't mind doing that, stand to your feet, heads are bowed, eyes closed. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Thank you for coming tonight. I'm so grateful you have. And I know some of you folks that are senior citizens, maybe this message does not really be that which vibes with your present experience, but I trust it will encourage your heart and know how to pray for your young people. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Here's what we're going to do. Just a moment, I'll ask our pianist to begin to play, and all I'm going to ask is if you've got some things God wants you to do, to talk to him about, I would encourage you to sit. You say, Preacher, I don't think I can, but I'll tell you what you can do, is you can pray. And I encourage some of you to confess that, God, I'm a thief. I never really saw it that way, but when I was 16, I had that relationship with that girl. I was a thief. I took what I was not rightfully mine to take. God, would you forgive me? You need to come to me. You need to say, God, you're right on this thing. I was wrong. And you know what God will do? He'll forgive you. That's what 1 John 1:9 says. And just so if you need to just do some business with God, maybe some of you need to say, you know what? I'm not careful enough on what I'm looking at. Or maybe some need to say, you know what? I got to make an appointment with pastor. God, I need to make an appointment with pastor. I got to come clean on the battles I'm facing. I'm getting defeated on a regular basis in my thought life. And the things I'm looking at, I need help. I'm telling you, friend, there's a way out. But it's becoming clean with God, honest with God, and honest with people who love you and can help you. And so you do what God wants you to do as the piano plays. Would you do that? Just to spend time with God. Come to the front and pray, you can. If you want to sit and pray, you can. You just do what God touches your heart. Maybe a teenager or a child just simply wants to say, God, I want to, would you keep me pure? Would you keep me pure in an impure world? Maybe a mom and dad want to pray for your teenagers or your preteens. I don't know. Just do what God tells you to do. Just do whatever He tells you. Seconds here.
Pastor does send his wishes, but please be in prayer from Assembly with her sickness and help them to get better soon. Don't forget, this coming week, we have our revival, June 19th through the 22nd. Please be in prayer for that and prepare your hearts for what God has for each and every one of us. Also, on June 18th, we have our ladies' brunch, which is going to be at 10 o'clock here at the church. You can sign up at the welcome desk for that. And then our men's skeet shoot at 4 o'clock. And sign up for that as well. Bring things for chili or dessert. We do need people to sign up so we know who to get information to and so we can plan on how many we're going to have for that. That is all I have. And then, Zach Terry, would you mind closing us in a word of prayer?
Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight. Lord, just want to thank you for your will sending the evangelist here tonight, Lord. Give us a great message tonight, Lord, as we go on for the purity in our life, Lord. We pray that you keep us all clean. Keep the church clean of the sin of the world, Lord. Just allow us to go dive in after you. Lord, as we all travel home tonight, Lord, we ask you to give us safe travels. Lord, we ask you all these things in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.